first thing I'm doing is cutting my side rails to length using a 1x6 that I had left over. I said in the other video to use a 1x4. If you use a 1x6, you just have to cut it in half to width later on. That's what I'm going to do. Then I go outside and set up the table saw I just acquired. And the first thing I'm doing is cutting down this 4 foot by 8 foot by 1/4 inch thick sheet of plywood, and I'm cutting it to the width of the shelves. This is a very thin piece of plywood, obviously, and as such, it bends very easily. And without having a runoff table here, it gets straight up sketchy. So the first pass, I'm actually going a little bit wider than I need. Then you'll see me go back and narrow up the cut when I have a smaller, more manageable piece to deal with, and then flip it over, do the same thing on the other side to clean up the other edge. After confirming that this is the width that I want it to be, I take it back to the miter saw and I cut off a strip that's a lot more manageable to deal with, so I'm not dealing with an 8 foot long strip of plywood and I only have about a 2.5 to 3 foot section. Then I cut the depth of one of the shelves, I put a bunch of sunglasses on it to check it, and then go back and cut the rest of the shelves to the same size once I'm happy with the size that I've cut. Next thing we're going to do is trim the sideboards to the correct width. So I started with a 1x6 instead of a 1x4, like I said I would use in the other video. Either way, it doesn't really matter. You're just going to cut it down to the correct width anyhow. So for a 1x6, it's a little bit under half the total width of the board. So that way you can use a single length of the board versus using twice as much length on a 1x4. But either way, it's going to be the same concept. Next, we notch the corner of these two side rails so the back panel can fit flush against the sides. Then I abruptly decide that the remaining plywood is taking up way too much space and is definitely getting my way out here. So in lieu of tripping over it all day, I'm going to move it inside and get it out of my way. Now that we're back in the basement, I'm breaking out an actual 1x4, and what I'm doing is cutting this a little bit longer than the width of the shelves. That way it has a little bit of overhang on the front of the shelves, and this is going to be like a front cap, so you don't see the exposed ends of the plywood. We'll come back to these in a bit, but two sections is more than enough to make all the cap pieces you'll need. Coming back outside to the table saw now, what I'm doing is setting the blade depth to notch the side rails so that the shelving can fit inside of those slots on the side rails, and it's just a little bit more supported and makes it a little bit less likely to deform over time based on moisture, humidity, temperature, whatever. And it should give this shelf a lot more longevity, especially with the amount of use that it's going to get and how long I want it to last. Now in the other video where I do the full explanation on how I build this, I show the measurements at one point that shows how far apart these shelves are spaced. Here I'm actually kind of calculating that out as I cut it, so I'm not going to show all those dimensions here. But what you'll notice I'm doing, and this is the easiest way to do it, is because it's symmetric on one side versus the other, pass it through on one side, then just flip the boards 180 degrees, and then hit it at the other side because the spacing from the ends should be the same in both cases. Now I'm doing this the whole way down on both sides to make sure that I get all the slots cut, and then you'll see me go back and have to widen up and do a couple cleanup passes just to make sure that these shelves actually fit within those slots. So a couple of them were a little bit too narrow when I did the first pass. That's what you see me going back for, so just clean it up a little bit and widen them so that the shelves all fit and that I don't have to have too tight of a fitment that might eventually crack the sideboard. And that's what I'm still doing here in these upcoming close-ups. So I'm still just trying to clean this up. If I had a dado blade, dado spelled D-A-D-O, it would have taken all this out in a single strip, and that actually would have been ideal. But because I only have a standard saw blade, because I just got this thing and I'm poor, I'm just doing multiple passes with it and it's just taking a little bit longer. Now we go back to those two boards we cut earlier that I said we're going to turn into those front trim pieces. So I'm cutting those somewhere between like 1/2 and 3/4 inch wide, and then I'm leaving the 3/4 inch dimension for the height of these. Now you can make these as thick or as thin as you want. It's just going to give a slightly different aesthetic to your board. That's really up to you. From a functional standpoint, I'm just looking to cover the exposed end of the plywood so I don't have to see that. And it also provides a small lip for the sunglasses to catch. That way, if you bump this hanger or the shelf wherever it's sitting, you're not going to knock all of your sunglasses onto the floor each time you accidentally bump into it. Now the two things that we are notching into these front trim pieces are a slot along the back that the shelf is going to rest into. Again, gives it a little more rigidity. And then we're going to notch the corners so that it kind of is a cutout that sits a little more recessed into the side rails. I just like how that looks personally. You don't have to do that, and you can put this straight onto the front if you really want. That's up to you. For me, I like the way that this looks more, but it is more cutting involved. Finishing up the first two here just as test pieces, then I try to mock everything up with a single shelf, the side rail, and that front piece. You can kind of see how what I'm going for here. Make sure everything fits like I want it to, then I go ahead and I cut the rest of these. And cutting these was very time consuming. Of course, my camera ran out of battery right as I was doing that, so I'm just gonna jump to the end product of all those being notched. But that is the big step that I cut a bunch of these spare strips for, is that notching step is very very likely to chip out some corners and or ruin a few of these, especially if you don't know what you're doing. So that's why I always recommend cutting a few extras. Now, when I went back and I dry fitted everything, I found the shelves were a little bit wider with what I initially cut compared to what I wanted my final design. So I'm going back now and I'm trimming those up to the correct size. My other video reflects this correct size already, so you don't have to redo this if you've already cut them. I cut both the width and the depth because both of them needed a slight adjustment. Then I cut the backer panel that's going to go around the entire back of the shelving. And of course, my memory card ran out right before I made that cut, so let's jump to me sanding. To sand, I was just using 120 to 180 grit with an orbital sander, just trying to take down all the sharp edges. You're going to spend a lot of time touching this because it is a relatively narrow grab zone, so the likelihood of you coming in contact with this as you're using this routinely is pretty high. So for that reason, really take your time, make sure you get all the splinters and sharp edges off. A lot of small pieces here, very time consuming process, very tedious, so don't be afraid to take your time again. This is another really high opportunity for you to chip out some of the edges on those front trim pieces. Again, this is why you want to have more, and then you can throw out the ugliest ones at the end and only use the ones that look the best. With that in mind, the most efficient way I found to do this was to line up a bunch of the ones in the same direction at the same time, and then try to sand the top surface of all of them at once. So this won't help you on the corners, this won't help you with any of the burrs or anything around the edges, but it will help you getting a lot of that surface area done in a more rapid approach. With all the sanding done, it's easiest to transport these if you stack everything on that back panel. Then I brought them inside to stain. Yes, I said inside because I clearly was not thinking on this day and my house stunk for probably a solid day after I did this. Now, I've done my fair share of staining projects and woodworking projects in general, so I kind of have the confidence and the ability to not make a mess and to do it over a kitchen counter like this, even though I still had to lay down a piece of cardboard as protectant. But I would not recommend doing something like this if you are relatively new, or if you're messy, or if you don't really have that level of attention to detail. You're going to ruin your counters. I've already done a staining explanation video, I'll link that in the description. But again, these are all small pieces, there's a lot of nooks and crannies. Really take your time, make sure you get all the surfaces here. Some people like to stain after they have everything assembled, but because there's so many edges and so many joints that we're making, especially on a project like this, for me it makes more sense to stain it beforehand because the wood glue at every one of those seams has the potential to impact the stain that you're going to put on afterwards. So especially on something like this where there's just so many hard to reach places once you assemble it, and there's just so much area that the glue is going to be in contact with, for me I think the risk of something going wrong because of the glue impacting the stain is worth staining everything beforehand to get rid of that possibility entirely. Another difficulty with having so many small pieces is you really have to coordinate ahead of time prior to staining how you're going to lay all these out to dry. So you'll notice on like the bottom right, for example, all those little front trim pieces, I already checked how much space I needed and had to space between them prior to staining them, so I knew how much space they would take up. All of the shelves, I already figured out how much space it would take to stand those all up, although if you want to do that, it's a little bit difficult. It will create a domino effect if you knock any of them over, which I totally did at least one time when I was trying to set them up ahead of time. Just try to plan your space accordingly for how much space you have available, or just get a work area that's much bigger than the total amount of materials that you're dealing with. I mentioned this in the other video as well, but because there's a lot of nooks and crannies, a flathead screwdriver, use that to press the rag into the corners to get some of those like sharp and more narrow areas. And as with any staining project, when you're doing something over an extended period of time, for example, if you have a bunch of little tiny pieces that you're hitting, make sure to keep your stain well mixed throughout, maybe give it a swirl every now and then. I probably could have been a little bit better about it here, but like I said, I don't think my brain was functioning that day because instead of doing everything outside, I decided to stain it on my kitchen counter like an absolute idiot. That said, I am wearing a respirator here. At the bare minimum, inside or outside, wear a respirator. Otherwise, you are just going to have one heck of a time killing your brain cells. Now, you can make this process go a little bit quicker if you don't hit all the areas that won't be visible. So, for example, inside all these channels. But I'm just too much of a perfectionist and a completionist, so I just had to get all the nooks and crannies. I didn't want any risk whatsoever of seeing an unstained surface. After giving the stain an ample amount of time to cure so that the glue would not be affected by it, I went out and I started assembling everything. So I applied all the glue, spread it with a Q-tip, and then I struggled to figure out the best way to hold this as I nailed it in place. And the way that I found was easiest was to put the side rail on a flat surface. So I got like the board on the bottom here, hold a square on the back side, and then just clamp that backboard against the square that is also against the side rail, then tack the nail in at the end. Once you get the first nail or two into position, it's really easy to just go down and get the rest of them. The first nail or two are really the only struggle when you're setting this up. After the whole board is secure, go back with your Q-tip, use a clean Q-tip as much as you need to change that thing out and wipe up all of your excess glue. Even though the stains had like 24 hours to set up here, it still has the potential to be affected by the wood glue unless you wait like a full week or two. Just something to keep in mind, extra glue can discolor your stain. Repeat for the other side rail, then test fit one of your bottom shelves prior to installing it, then apply your glue, insert it into place, and don't worry about it if there's some gaps around it at first, if it's shifting. You're gonna go and get all these into place. Then when you put on the very top and the very bottom shelves, that's when you're going to tack those in place with a nail. That's what's going to be holding the whole thing together. And what you'll see me do when I'm putting on the very top board here, I'm not using an actual wood clamp to clamp this thing together because I don't want to make the sides too bowed in. What I'm really just looking to do is keep them relatively straight. So I got it pretty close by hand based on where the wood wanted to stop on its own, but you could use a square if you're really worried about it. My square actually wouldn't fit between these shelves, so that's why I didn't put mine in there. Then it's the same thing of rapidly changing out Q-tips, wipe up as much of the excess glue as you can from all the seams, all the corners, front and back. You don't want to have any chance of discoloring your stain down the road. Finally, we're placing those front trim pieces over the top. I just put them all on first and then I came back with the nail gun after. I don't want to put in too many nail holes in the front of this because obviously those are visible, so I only did one nail hole per side per board. Nice and clean, keep it relatively centered. Take your time on this. You are going to see this unless you go back to fill these in after. After a final glue wipe, we're ready to hang everything up. So I'm just putting an eye loop in each of those two sideboards and putting a wire between them. Then I have a picture hanger that I bent a little more flush and that's going on the wall. The wire is just going to hang off of that picture hanger. And personally, the placement in the closet for me doesn't need to be to the nearest millimeter. I don't really care that much about the accuracy. So I just got it eyeballed close enough, placed my picture hanger into the wall and then hung this up. And it actually came out pretty well. That being said, I've hung a lot of things on the wall before, so I'm very good at eyeballing where the hangers need to go. Feel free to measure it out if you're not comfortable doing that. Anyway, here's the final result. I know the colors look different on a previous shot, but that's a camera issue. They actually match very well. So that is all I have for this time. Thank you guys for watching, and I will see you next time.